Session, the working wife and mother here at the Faith for the Family Couples Retreat. It is my honor and privilege to introduce the speaker for this session, a woman that I think is the most fantastic, wonderful, working woman, non-working woman on the face of the planet. So my wife, just to give you a little bit of a background, her name is Jessica Jones, and she has been a faithful companion. We've been married now for 17 years, going on 17 years. Next week is our 17th year anniversary, so we're looking forward to that. But she spent the first half of her life dedicated to staying at home, raising our children, and then we got through all four children. Our first four children were in school, and then we had talked about once the children got into school, maybe she would look into working back outside the home because she loves working and very smart woman, very capable woman. And so she was able to take a position. And then a year into that position, we ended up with being blessed with baby number five. So we now have a two-year-old at home. So she is a true working mother and a wonderful woman and a wonderful wife. So without further ado, I'll give you my wife, Mrs. Jessica Jones.
Well, good morning. I'm so excited to be up here in front of you. I'm so thankful for this opportunity. Can I take this off? I feel a lot more comfortable having something in my hand. All right, well, my name is Jessica Jones, and I am so thankful that Pastor has given me this privilege to be able to speak to you this morning, and he had asked me to speak, and the title of my session is The Working Wife and Mother. And of course, I thought, well, that's me, isn't it? That's me, I'm the working wife and I'm the working mother. And I thought, well, maybe I need to retitle this. Maybe I need to retitle this as Supermom. Maybe I should retitle it as the super wife, or super woman, or maybe just super tired. What do you think? So let's just get to know each other just real quick. How many in here can tell me, yes, I am a working mom. I am a working wife. I'm a working mom. Obviously, that's why you're in here, so that's wonderful. Well, I want to take just a few minutes, and I want to be able to just tell you a little bit about myself and how the Lord has used some things in my life. Forgive my voice. I've been battling bronchitis since December, and so it's a little bit in my throat this morning, but if you could just be patient with me, we'll get through this very well. So, well, at the age of six, I accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, and I grew up in a preacher's home. How many preacher children do we have in here? We have a few. Wonderful. Well, I thought my life was perfect. I had everything. My mom and dad had done such a wonderful job raising me. And I found my mom was just perfect. She made peanut butter jelly sandwiches with a perfect consistency. Have you guys had parents that way? When you watched her clean, it's like, how could she clean so well? And she always makes me go back to clean my room for the third time because it wasn't right. Well, she instilled a lot of things in me, and I'm very thankful for that. But she also instilled in me about being a wife. And I watched her, and I watched my dad, and I watched them pray together. And I watched them serve the Lord together. And I just started praying. My dad challenged me at a very young age to pray for my future husband, put together a list of things that makes for a perfect husband, and sure enough, I did. And I came to just love and long for the idea to get married. Well, in about fifth grade, this very cute boy started riding my dad's church bus. And he started coming in. Well, by seventh grade, I thought, boy, he's pretty cute. And within just a few months, I thought, Lord, I think that's the man I'm going to marry. And of course, I would not suggest that today, but it worked for us. And so my husband, he came on the church bus. He started serving faithfully. My dad brought him right next to him and just mentored him. And we grew up together as junior high sweethearts. Well, he started to take on some leadership, and he started to grow. We went to high school together. And when we both went to public school, when he was in public school, he was known as the Rebel on the football team. And it helped me get through the public school time in my life. Well, he became leaders, and we had our eyes focused on the Lord together as best friends. And that's where it started. Well, after that, he went off to pharmacy school. And after pharmacy school, we were married about 2 years into. He's got two more years left of pharmacy school, and I took this wonderful position working at a tire company, and I just loved and adored what I did. And I told the Lord, okay, Lord, we got pregnant and we were expecting in 2001, and I said, I'm going to hang that up, and we're going to go ahead, and I'm going to stay at home and be a stay-at-home mom for 12 years I was. And I thought, oh, Lord, this is wonderful. My life is perfect. I have everything I've ever wanted, and my husband became the apple of my eye. And before we were actually having children, I would see his socks rolled up in a ball, and I thought, oh, that's so cute. And I would think, oh, the cookies on the counter and the cookies and milk that he would leave over all night in the evening on the end tables. And I thought, he needs me. He needs me to clean up his mess. And I'm so thankful for this opportunity to be the best wife I possibly could be. And I always longed to be that wife, always longed to be that perfect mother. And of course, when we had children, and I hung up my job, and I thought, okay, Lord, I'm going to be the perfect mom. I'm going to do everything just right. And more the time went along, I realized those nights that I envisioned would just be so beautiful started to be crying babies and spit up. And we thought, Lord, maybe I don't have this figured out. And it was an up and down roller coaster emotionally. Well, After we started going with having all of our children, we had four children, and I was very thankful for the opportunity to have four children. And I thought, okay, Lord, this is great. Well, in January 2009, my husband came to me, and at the time, he was a full-time pharmacist. He worked in my dad's church full-time as the youth director, and I thought life just couldn't get any better. We have the white picket fence. We have the dog in the front yard, and he came to me, and he said, Jessica, I feel like the Lord's calling me to go to Bible college. And I said, what? I said, well, that's great. You know, that my mom had always told me to be submissive and cheer on your husband. And I thought, well, that's fantastic. When are you going to start your online studies? And he says, oh, no, we're moving. I've only known Ohio. This cannot be happening to me. And so sure enough, we put our house on the market in January. And he said, we'd be living in Tennessee by June. And I watched the Lord just really work in his heart. And of course, myself, I'd always been taught submission. And I thought, Lord, this isn't for me, but I'm going to keep my mouth shut. Boy, we have a lot to learn, don't we, ladies? And gentlemen, there's some gentlemen here too. But you know, the Lord just really worked in my heart and worked in my heart and softened my heart. And I said, okay, Lord, whatever you want. We moved here within just a few minutes, 5 minutes after we pulled in, we got a phone call at our household in Ohio. It was that moment that I realized it wasn't about me. The Lord wanted to do something special in my life. I was no longer riding the coattails of my mom and dad's faith. It was all about what the Lord was going to do with my family. So he began to take his masters, and I thought, okay, Lord, life is starting to come together again. I have a little bit of control again in my life. And so sure enough, I had always prayed when I was younger that when my youngest would go to kindergarten, I would get back into the workforce. So sure enough, I'm not even exaggerating. The same month that Levi started kindergarten, I got a phone call from Pastor. He called me in his office. He said, I have a job for you to do. And I just thought, this is it. I've arrived. I have all the answers again. I've got my life under control. And so sure enough, I started as the director of admissions at Crown College. And I fell in love with it. Oh, it was just everything. My kids were going to Christian school. My husband was a full-time pharmacist as well as a full-time youth pastor. And life just couldn't be perfect. I had everything under control, or so I thought. Well, I found out about 3 or 4 months later, I called Miss Sexton, and I was in tears. I thought, how in the world can this happen? How did this happen? Well, of course, we all know how this happens. But I was told I couldn't have any more children. How in the world can I start all over? I got rid of everything. I had four beautiful children. I had 2 boys and 2 girls, which I had always prayed for, and now I have to start over. And you know what my biggest fear was? Lord, I cannot have crumbled up Cheerios in the bottom of my van again. I'm over that. I cried for 10 months. You can ask any of my friends. I cried for 10 months. Lord, this is not your will. This cannot be my will. And I started to pray. I thought, Lord, do I go back to work? That was the big question. Do I stay home? I've always stayed home with my children. I'm going to have to eat my words. I said, I'd always stay home with my children. Well, the Lord was just really working in my heart. I got to where I was just a few months away from having Titus. And I had gone to a Sunday night service, and I threw my hands up in the air. I said, Lord, okay, maybe it's my will that I want to go back to work. I can't find anybody to watch my child. I need you to intervene. I need you to do something amazing in my life to show me how much you love me, and I'm right in the center of your will. And if you want me to go back to work, you have to provide a babysitter. That next Monday morning, I'm not even exaggerating, Dr. Prescott came to my office. He said, I have something very odd I need to share with you. I said, okay. He said, I'm just convinced I need to get rid of all of this nursery stuff in my house. And he said, I told my wife, you need to just get rid of it. She said, honey, I can't. I just really believe the Lord wants me to watch the Jones baby. I literally about fell out of my chair. You know, so often we pray, we ask the Lord to answer our prayers, and then so many times we don't really believe that God can do it. And the Lord really showed himself to me that day that I have to trust the Lord. Well, Titus came. I call him my unexpected blessing. And the Cheerios in the bottom of my van, it doesn't bother me near as much as I thought it would. It's funny how we get so worked over the little things and how we really need to keep things in perspective. Ladies, I lost my super cape. I thought, I can't work. I started to get to the point where I felt like I was losing my joy and my confidence because life was just so busy with 5 children now, working full-time, being in the ministry. And I know all of you ladies can definitely relate. It's difficult. I found myself frustrated. I found myself crying. I found myself just crazy psycho. I love that analogy. And my husband, as much as he tried to console me, he could not console me. And I realized, Lord, what is the answer? I searched everywhere. I searched on Pinterest. I searched in my Bible. I searched on Facebook. I asked my friends, what's the secret answer? How can I be the best wife? How can I be the best mother? And work full time. How do I do it? Well, I realized in my devotion, the Lord came to me and really helped me. When I read my Bible, I always tell myself, Lord, I'm going to read until you speak to me. It may be one chapter, it may be one verse, or maybe 3 chapters, or 10 chapters. I always read until the Lord speaks to me. And there was a day that the Lord really came to me and helped me, and I came across this verse. Turn your Bibles to Psalms 91, verses 1 and 2. This verse has meant so much to me, and it's helped me. It says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, he and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Look at that verse, ladies. He that dwelleth. To dwell is not something that you just show up on a Sunday. It's not something that you show up on Wednesday and open your Bible. This is something that dwelleth. This is daily. This is something you have to work at daily. And when you work at it daily, you'll see in that second part, it's a secret place. You know, as a kid, we always used to take old pallets, and we used to build these big fortresses out of these pallets. And we called it our what? Our secret place. And we would go in there, we'd crawl in there, and we'd be in there for hours. Hours. My brothers and I and our neighbors, we just loved it. And I think of that. It says, he that dwells in the secret place of the Most High, our God and our Creator wants us to be close to him. He wants us to have a daily relationship with him. And yes, I was reading my Bible every day, but I found myself in a rut. Do you ever get stuck in a rut with your Bible reading where the Lord just feels like he's a million miles away? That's where I was. And I came to really understand that I wanted to be in his shadow, but to be in a shadow, you have to be right next to him all the time. When the Bible talks about praying without ceasing, that's right. Continuous prayer. It's not, okay, I prayed for my breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and I'll pray at bedtime. No. That's every moment of the day. While I'm walking down my hallway at work, Lord, you have to help me. I am so weak right now. I can't even stand. I have to have your help. And when you're constantly seeking the Lord, and you're constantly asking the Lord for help, that's when you're staying close to him, and with your Bible reading. So, it says in that next verse, and I love this, it says, I will say of the Lord. It says, I. You have to claim it, ladies. We find ourselves so insecure, don't we? I do. I look fat one minute. I'm sad the next minute. I feel like an emotional roller coaster. And I think all of us can attest to that. And it says, he is my refuge. He is my fortress. My God. It's ownership. The heaven that the Lord created and the world that the Lord created is the same God that I serve, and he wants me to draw close to him. It's a powerful thing when we can grasp that. Well, there's 3 things I really want to point out that really helped me. The moment that you take your eyes off of Christ is when you feel like a failure. And there are days, oh ladies, there are days I feel like a failure. I feel like I'm not being the wife I need to be. I'm not being the mother I need to be. And it's a struggle. When they say the struggle is real, I say that to myself quite often. Lord, I need you. I need you. So keep your eyes on Christ. So number one, if you're writing notes, you need to understand, you have to draw close to the Lord personally. This is a place that your husband cannot fill, that secret place. This is a place that your children can never fill. The Lord has put order in your life. We have to understand that. Christ has to be first, always. Sometimes we find ourselves even putting our children before our husbands. That's dangerous. And Ms. Kay, you spoke about that in the last session. It was powerful. Christ is always first in our life. It says in Psalms 37, 23 through 24, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholdeth him in his hand. And it also says in James 4, 8, draw nigh unto God, and he will draw nigh unto you. Ladies, if there's one secret that I can tell you, you cannot live your day without Christ. Because when the day that you do is the day that you fail. Also, we need to set an unchangeable time and place for God each day. So your Bible reading and prayer has to be essential. And I know, being a working mom, it's difficult. Psalms 46:10, be still. Be still. That's laughable sometimes, isn't it? Be still. Sometimes my husband and I'll get to the end of the day, and we'll just be sitting there on the couch and there's no TV. And we'll look at each other and we're like, do you hear that? Do you hear that? Of course, we have a house with five children. It's called silence. And it's a beautiful, beautiful sound. I've never understood that until I had five children. But there is a secret place that we can go to with the Lord and with each other as husband and wife. Also, don't try to manage a single day in your own strength. Isaiah 40:31, but they that wait. Now, when I think of wait, I think of being still. It all ties together. Wait upon the Lord shall renew your strength. Seek God's wisdom each day when you need it. Psalms 8:17, I love them that love me, and those that seek me early shall find me. Now, ladies, I have a confession to make. I'm not a morning person. I try to be. I really do. But I have to actually purpose in my heart to be a morning person. By doing so, you can put some things. Put it.
Move your hand up.
Move my hand up. Got it? Okay. By doing so, you are going to be able to put things in order in your home. I'm going to give you some real applicable things that you can put in your life and your morning routine that's going to help you. So, number one, draw close to the Lord. Here we go. Number two, simplify. This is powerful, ladies. Simplify. When God has his rightful place in our life, it's no longer about pleasing my husband and my children, it's about pleasing our Savior, and everything else falls into place. Life becomes simpler. So, put yourself on a routine. With that being said, put yourself in a morning routine. We have purpose in our family life. Of course, everybody has a different way of doing things, and it's okay. But what we have done is we have decided to say, okay, we are going to wake up. Everyone has to get up. Everyone needs to get their beds made. Everyone needs to have everything done and ready by 7:15. At 7:15, we are sitting around our dining table with our Bibles, and we're reading our Bible together as a family. We are praying, and by 7:30 or 7:35, we're ready to start our day. And by doing that, ladies, it's helped us. It's helped our children to be put on a routine. It's so very, very important to have that family altar time. Some people decide to do it in the evenings. We've decided to do it in the mornings. Of course, we pray together in the evenings as a family. But when we start our day with the Lord, Jesus Christ has helped me to stay and keep my eyes on Christ. The next thing, a bedtime routine. How many of you guys have ladies? I shouldn't say how many of you guys. That's the northern in me coming out, I guess. How many of you ladies have young children and you have like under the age of five? Wonderful. If I can say one thing that can help you as a mother, have a solid bedtime routine. Now, you have to be flexible, especially with you in the ministry, but have a solid. If there's one thing that's helped my husband and I, we've discussed this several times, that's helped our children, is they know exactly what to do, and they're in bed by 8:30. And I'll tell you why it's so important, not just for the children to be put on a routine, but it's so important for your husband. When you're letting your children stay up till 11 o'clock and you're exhausted and you're going to bed without saying two words to your husband, that's not good. By going to bed at 8:30, that's putting some time that you can get stuff picked up and you can be able to start your night with your husband and you can spend some good quality time with your husband. Number three, assign your children chores. That's a wonderful thing, especially as a working mom. You just can't do it all yourself. So even my little Titus, he's gonna be two, he helps out. As a matter of fact, the other day he's in a garbage bag. I had two of them. I had a really light one and a really heavy one. I took the heavy one and he grabbed the little one. I thought, oh, this is nice. I've done something right. And as I was dragging it, he was dragging his behind me and I drug it to the garage and here he comes, dragging it right behind me. And he got done and he put it in the garage and he starts clapping. He says, yay! And I thought, oh, I didn't even try that. But it worked. So he's catching on. Every one of my children have chores. Now, ladies, I don't have all the answers, but I will tell you, it's helped me to be able to put our children with some chores. The next, share the gospel as a family. It's so important to strengthen your faith by sharing the gospel. Get your children involved in the ministries. Sometimes we, as husband and wives, we get together and go, we're going full steam with our ministry, and then our children are left behind. That's how we're neglecting our children. We have to keep our children involved. Pray with your children. Pray with your husband. Read your Bible together. Ladies, and of course, Kay did such a wonderful job on this. I don't really need to go into this, but kiss your husband every day. Tell him how much you love him. Tell him how much he needs you, or how much he needs you, how much you need him. You are his biggest cheerleader. You are his biggest cheerleader. If there's one thing I've learned from JoJo Moffitt, she's always talking about being a cheerleader for your husband. Oh, ladies, we need to be cheerleaders every day of our life. And every day, we need to find the key to your children's heart. The key to my oldest, Madison's heart, is not the same key that opens Titus's heart. And as a matter of fact, my two daughters, they have very different keys that open their heart. Find it and use it every day to make them feel so important. Make time for yourself. Ms. Kay talked about this too. It's so important to exercise and eat right. Of course, I'm still working on that. Oh, it's so hard. How many of you guys are fighting that exercise thing? Yes. I thought, okay, I'm going to wake up at 5:30, and I'm going to go out, and I'm going to run. And I'm going to run, and I'm going to go outside, and I'm just going to run laps around my neighborhood. And so the first time I did it, there was a skunk. And it stunk so bad. I thought, oh, Lord, I can't do this. I can't do this. So it's a daily struggle, but we have to work at it. It's so important. All right, be organized. So not just have a routine, but be organized. Schedule your day. Pastor Sexton always says this, plan your work, and work your plan. If you don't have a plan, it's not gonna get done. Put ball games and doctor's appointments, birthday parties, Bible studies, youth events, piano lessons, get it all on the schedule. All four of my children take piano lessons. They're involved in every sport imaginable. I'm the taxi driver, I'm everything. And sometimes it can be a struggle, but we know that we have a God, that he wants us to draw close to him. He wants to simplify our life. And by doing so, I'll share just one of that last point. Also, schedule your hot dates. As a matter of fact, if you ask anyone I work with, my husband will come and get me, and he says, we're going to go to lunch. And I'll walk out, and I'll look at Ms. Holt. I said, Shana, I'm going on a hot date. I'll be back in an hour. And you know, I found some of the coworkers saying the same thing when their husband came and got them for lunch. I'm going on a hot date. Don't lose that passion for your husband. Make him feel like, whoo, let's go on a hot date. Sometimes, ladies, as working moms, that hour lunch break is your only hot date you're going to get. So keep that in mind. Also, work to keep your house clean, but don't be overwhelmed. Don't be overwhelmed. I have a very big problem with this, and as my husband is sitting here listening to me, he is going to completely agree she has a problem. She is OCD. I am. I have to work at it every day. It says in Proverbs 14:4, where no oxen are, the crib is clean, but with much increase is by the strength of the ox. Keep that, remember that. Also, develop a flexible schedule. Like I said, in the ministry and working, you have to be flexible. Sometimes the Lord just throws a wrench in there to see how you're gonna handle it. And you just wanna make sure you're prepared, your spirit filled to handle that situation. Use your crock pots, ladies. That's one way to be flexible and be organized. Oh, that's become my best friend. I love it. I put my crock pot on in the morning, and when I get home, it's there. Also, I recruit my family. My daughters are getting old enough where they can help me now. Oh, what a blessing that is. So what I do, I'll go out and I'll go grocery shopping and I'll put a list of every type of meal they can make for that week on this chalkboard. And when they make it, if, for example, if there may be something very easy, like spaghetti. Well, they know how to make spaghetti. They can get dinner going before I get home from work. And when they have it done, they cross it off. So we know there's more meals. Sometimes something will come up and we've only got 45 minutes before we have to be at Wednesday night workers meeting. Lord, help me, I cannot do this. But when they see Sloppy Joe's on that menu, on that chalkboard, oh, I can make Sloppy Joe's. And they have it ready when we get home. My husband, matter of fact, this past Wednesday, he knew that we had chicken patty sandwiches in the freezer. He had the chicken patty sandwiches ready for when I walked in the door. It's fantastic to be that organized and that your family is working together as a team, because that's what the Lord wants. He wants us to be able to bring glory and honor to Him with everything we do, whether it be a stay-at-home mom to be a working mom. We need to remember that. A good friend reminded me, trying to keep your house clean with children living in it is like trying to brush your teeth while you're trying to eat Oreos. And ladies, that's so true. Right now I have Titus the tornado. He's gonna be 2 in a few weeks. And the minute I have my house wonderfully clean, is the minute he's coming right behind me. So have a place for everything, and everything has a place. If you don't have a place for it, get rid of it. How many of you guys are hoarders? You love to keep things in your house. I'm the opposite. I throw everything away. And I always regret it. But take time once a month to declutter your home. This is very important. The less stuff means, the less you clean, the less you organize, the less you have to store, and in all, you have the less mess. So keep that, it's very important as a working mom that you keep things in order. Throw away broken toys, organize closets and drawers, cycle through clothes and shoes that are too small, and donate them. Before you leave for work in the morning, this is something I've adapted, and it's helped me to stay constantly at it. I'll empty the dishwasher from the night before, I'll put it away, I'll put all my breakfast dishes in there, I'll start it, I'll go to the laundry room, I'll get my load of laundry started, I'll get everything going, I'll get my bed made, and so when I come home from work, I don't have to be frazzled. I walk in the door, and my husband can attest to this, some days I'll walk in the house, and I get in the flesh. Do any of you guys get in the flesh when you walk in the door? I have to prepare myself as I'm driving home, or my house may be a mess. But when I put purpose in my heart that it's okay, God is in control, and He comforts my heart and knows that I can't be that super mom all the time. I can't get it all done. I will do the best I can for the Lord to bring glory to the Lord. So the last point also, ask for help. Sometimes ladies, we just need help. And it might be the point where you say, okay, honey, I need some help with this house. And you can hire somebody to come clean your house that week for $50. And that's going to take off so much stress. Financially, some people can do that. With me working, I'm able to have a college student come to my house and work 10 hours a week. She helps me pick my kids up and bring them home. She helps me get my house clean. She helps my girls, my kids with their homework. And by the time I get home, everything's in order. And it's such a big help and relief. And it does help. It does hurt a little bit financially, but it does help me to be able to keep doing what I'm doing. And God has made Himself so real to me with that. Live passionately is my third point. And how you can live passionately is by first drawing close to the Lord. When you draw close to the Lord, and then you simplify your life, the outcome is living passionately. This is a direct result. This is my life verse, Jude 22. And of some have compassion, making a difference. Oh, ladies, I want to be a difference maker. I want to be a difference maker. My heart just overflows with, I want to help people. I want to be in the ministry. I want to be the best Christian mother and best Christian wife I possibly could be, living passionately. I want to reach people for Christ. I want them to know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. But I can't do it in my own strength. It's so easy to be able to try to do it in your own strength. We're superwoman, right? That's what they say. How many of you have been asked that question? How do you do it? How do you do it? These are the keys. This is how you can know how to do it. If you live passionately, you will have joy. You will have joy. It says in Psalm 16:11, I shared this verse with my husband this morning. I said, boy, this is a powerful verse, isn't it? It says, thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness, joy. At the right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. I want to be so full of joy, ladies. There was a point in time in my life, a few years back, when I was searching how to be that perfect mom and perfect wife. And I thought, I'm losing it. I'm losing my joy. And that's dangerous when we lose our joy. Go back to Psalms 51. When I start doubting my relationship with the Lord, thinking I'm a failure, it's I need to get right with God. Keep short accounts with Him. Psalms 51 is a cleansing prayer. Read it. I think there's a week, every week I try to read that chapter to cleanse myself, to keep my focus right with Christ. Also, if you have joy in your life, you're going to laugh. With five kids and working, it can be pretty hysterical, let me tell you. And capture those moments. Take pictures and take video. Here's something that I've done personally that maybe might help you. I have taken and I've written a journal. And I put that journal, every night I'll write something about it, something funny that's happened. And as I was preparing for this, I started pulling out those journals and reading them. Oh, I read to my husband, I said, do you remember when Levi took a bouncy ball and put it in the toilet and flushed it? Let me read this to you. And we laughed as that ball got stuck. And we didn't have the money to buy a new toilet, so he was just trying to fix it. And it was a mess. Let's just say that. It was a mess. But those moments brought so much joy to be able to just think back on to see how the Lord had done such great things in my life. If you have passion in your life, you're going to shine. You're going to shine in your home. You're going to shine for your husband. You're going to shine at your workplace. You're going to shine to your children. And it's all, as when it's all put together, your children will start emulating you. I want my children to be joyful. I want my children to be a better Christian than I am. But I have to put these things in my life to help my children and to help my husband. When you're laughing, you're going to shine, and also you're going to bear much fruit. John 15:5, I love this. It says, I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth, remember that abideth back in Psalms 91? He that abideth in the secret place. Here that word is again. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. Ladies, that's the point where we start to feel like a failure, doesn't it? Because we try to do it without Christ. But we realize that every day, putting Christ first in our life, will put everything else will fall into place. We will be the perfect wife. Let me turn to the next verse. It says in Galatians 5:22, and I love this verse. And these are things that you can add to your life. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit. Of course, we talk about fruit of the Spirit all the time, but this is very important. The fruit of the Spirit. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such, there is no law. It's very important, ladies, that we have that fruit of the Spirit constantly growing in our life. We want to be able to teach that to our children. We want to have that type of a home. I want to have a peaceful home. And sometimes we are so full of ourselves that we find ourselves not having a very peaceful home. And when we are not at peace, you know, the old adage that says, a happy wife is a happy life. And that's so true. We control the spirit of our homes. And it's very dangerous. And I will get caught up in it. My husband will help me to say, whoa, honey, you need to watch what you're saying and keep your tone right. And boy, sometimes you want to buck up as a woman, don't you? Don't you tell me what to do. No. It's very helpful that he keeps you. And that's the wonderful thing about having that relationship where your husband is correcting you and loving you at the same time to keep you accountable. And I do the same thing with him. And that's what the wonderful thing about marriage is, that you can do this together. The last thing, you will excel. I want to excel, ladies. I want to be the best wife, and I want to be the best mother I possibly can be. And the Lord says in the Bible, in God's word, I can excel. It says, Proverbs 31:29. Of course, you think of Proverbs 31, that is the working mother. And it gives you everything. I want to be like her. But then you really look at it and you think, oh, I can't be like this. It says in Proverbs 31:29, many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excellest them all. In order to excel, the key to being the working wife and mother is when I have Christ in his rightful place, I am the perfect wife to my husband. And when I have the rightful place in my life with Christ, I am the perfect mother to my children. God has given me my husband and my children, and he's going to equip me. If I abide in him and find rest, I can be that superwoman. I can have my kick back. And that's what I've come to realize, that when I put Christ first in my life, he's going to give me everything I need, and I keep my eyes on him. When you get asked that question, how do you do it? How do you work and have all those children? Of course, they can say a lot meaner things than that. I've heard them all, trust me. You have 5 kids? Oh, what's wrong with you? I've heard that. And when they ask, how do you do it? You just kindly reply, I don't, God does. And when that is your mindset, you have an amazing supernatural ability to be an amazing Christian woman, because it's not about you, it's about Christ. And that's what's important. Praise the Lord, his mercies are new every morning. You're going to wake up and think, I can do this. I'm going to be a super mom and a super wife today. And then you fail him. But guess what? It says in Lamentations 3:22, it is of the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed, because his compassions fail not. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. God is faithful. He wants to help you every day. All you have to do is ask. Ask every morning. Draw nigh to God. Draw as close as you can to the Lord. Simplify your life. And lastly, live passionately. When you draw close to the Lord and you simplify, the result is you're going to live passionately. You're going to have that joy. You're going to have everything you need to keep advancing. The Bible says we are more than conquerors. Ladies, I just want to put on my shield and my sword and charge the world saying, I've got the answers because I've got God's word. That's where it starts. So with that being said, let's go ahead and bow in prayer and ask the Lord to close out our session and get ready for the next one. Dear Heavenly Father, we're so grateful for today. Thank you, Lord, for the ladies that spoke before me. And I just pray, Lord, that you would be able to use that. I know it spoke to my heart so deeply. Thank you, Lord, for what you've done in our hearts this weekend. Thank you for this couples retreat and Pastor and Mrs. Sexton, how they put this together, and how I look forward to it every year is that time just to reset our marriage. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to share God's word about working. I pray, Lord, that we would put these in our life, Lord. And when we fail, we realize that you love us. And every day, we have new mercies with you. I just pray, Lord, that you'd help us and guide us, Lord. And help us to be more than conquerors as mothers and wives. And that you'd help us to be all that we can be through you and as our Savior. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.